I'm here with Dr. Laurence Baker from Stanford Medical School, and we're going to talk about what?
How about Medicare?
Medicare. I think we knew that was going to happen because we had this picture here already. And so what is this a picture of?
I think that's a picture of LBJ signing the Medicare Act in 1965. This is the time that we passed Medicare.
Lyndon Baines Johnson, LBJ. And this looks like Truman right over here.
I think so.
And maybe he was there because he, I think, was probably old enough by that point to be a recipient.
Yeah, of 65 Medicare. And over.
So I think we all have a general idea of what Medicare is, that it's kind of a health care program or an insurance program for people who are retired. But then it starts to get fuzzy after that, and there are all these details that confuse most of us.
Yeah, so we talk about Medicare in a bunch of different ways. Medicare is a program. It's a U.S. government program run by the federal government.
So it is run by the federal government.
Yep.
And sometimes it's thrown in with Medicaid. How are they different, just at a very high level?
Oh, so Medicaid is a different insurance program run by the federal government in coordination with state governments. So it's Medicaid is a federal and state program. Medicare is a federal program. Medicare is for folks who are 65 years old and older and people with disabilities, principally those two groups. Medicaid is a program that's aimed at lower income populations.
Okay. So this is older people and disabilities.
Yeah.
This is low income, kind of a poverty issue.
Yes, more so.
All right, let me write that down. Low income. And this is primarily retirees.
Vast majority of people in there are folks who are there because
older
they're
population.
Over 65.
Okay, and we're just going to focus on Medicare. And Medicare is the federal government. Medicaid is the federal and the state governments are in Medicaid because they sound very similar.
They sound very similar. Yes. Yeah, no, they're easily confused, certainly at the name level. Really different programs. They operate completely separately. In a few cases, there are people who get access to both of them, but they pay differently. They run differently. They're really
but at the
not
federal the level, they are still run by the same organization, the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare. Medicaid.
The Department of Health and Human Services has a subpart called the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services.
So if I have
CMS.
The executive branch.
Oh, yeah.
Let me. Executive branch of our government, obviously. And then you have the Secretary of Health.
Health and Human Services.
So Health and Human Services. Health and Human Services. And then within that,
you have CMS.
Which is the Centers for, and you were saying earlier, it should have two M's in it.
Yeah, it's the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, so I think it's just shorter to have one M.
But, one M.
Really,
instead
there's
of calling
two
it
in
CMMS.
There.
Okay. Right. Okay, and they administer at the federal level both Medicare and Medicaid.
Yep.
But just to reiterate, Medicare is really mainly a federal thing, while Medicaid is both. And they're
Medicare
run separately.
Entirely.
So you have Medicare here.
Yep.
Medicare, and then you have Medicaid here.
Yeah.
I see. Right. All right. So let's dive deep into Medicare. So is it? I guess what is it?
So Medicare is an insurance program. It provides insurance coverage for people who are eligible for it. So if you're age 65 and over, or if you have a permanent disability, a couple other small groups. If you have Lou Gehrig's disease or end-stage renal disease, kidney failure, then you can get access to Medicare too. But those are small populations. So if you're in those groups, you're eligible for Medicare. Medicare will provide you with insurance that will cover hospital bills, doctor bills, some prescription drugs. It'll cover lots of the medical care.
And is it, and you know, and I hear these things, you know, and this is the part that I think gets confusing for everyone, is that you start hearing Part A, Part B, Part C, Part D. I don't know if those are all the parts. What are right. those referring to, and are they
part.
Exactly insurance, or are they something slightly different?
So Medicare has these four parts, Part A, Part B, Part C, and Part D, and, you know, it can get a little confusing, but we could break it up into some different pieces. So the biggest one, in terms of the number of people who are in it, is what sometimes we call traditional Medicare, and that's what historically is Part A and Part B, and you kind of want to take those two together, because they make a package, and we call that maybe traditional Medicare, or sometimes people call it original Medicare. Standard Medicare. But, you know, when they passed the program, when they first did it, Part A was meant to cover hospital expenditures, and Part B was aimed at doctor costs for seeing physicians. Of course, those things go so closely together that nowadays Part A and Part B are kind of a pair. So you really rarely would find someone who only wanted Part A or only wanted Part
B. And sometimes you hear those doctor costs, it's outpatient. Like, so
it's aimed at
hospitals, sometimes you hear the word inpatient means you're living there while they're treating you. Outpatient, you go visit them for an hour or two and leave. And that's where you hear those.
Yeah, so that's a way of breaking up the kinds of services that medicine provides. Medicare actually gets a little bit And it's mix and match. So if really a Medicare Part A expenditure is when a hospital bills Medicare for use of the hospital, use of the room, use of the right. services at the hospital. Anytime a doctor bills Medicare, even if they saw the patient in the hospital, they're going to be a Part B expenditure.
I see. So it isn't strictly inpatient, outpatient. It really is much more along the lines of hospital and doctor.
Yep.
Okay. So
yep.
I'll maybe put this in some type of, I'll contain it away or something. It's okay. not necessarily outpatient, inpatient, but that's maybe one way of.
It's useful to think about okay. that, outpatient, inpatient. So,
And will it cover everything that happens? Are we including drugs or?
Okay, so drugs is one key issue. To the main question, the first thing mm-hmm. I guess I'd say is that Medicare, traditional Medicare, is pretty comprehensive. It covers, you know, most of the things that people would normally encounter in their right. needs for healthcare.
Does it cover
prescription
everything?
Drugs is one big exception.
It does not cut. So Parts A and Part B do not cover prescription drugs. So when Lyndon Johnson was signing this, if Truman had to get prescribed some drug and if he was a Medicare recipient, he would, in 1965, he would have had to pay that out of pocket.
I guess one caveat I'll note is that if you get prescription drugs that are administered to you while you're in the hospital,
I see.
You're staying in the hospital, they give you drugs, that's going to be generally covered under Part A. It's when you're outpatient and you're going home and then somebody sends you to the pharmacy to pick up
Medicare in its original form would not cover that.
They would not cover the outpatient prescription drugs.
I see.
So that became a problem for some folks, and that has generated changes to the Medicare program.
Right. Since
over
then,
time.
There is a part now that covers that.
Yeah. So that's the Part D program is a Medicare extension. I don't know how far we want to get afield.
Yeah, we can write that right here. We'll just D for drugs.
Yeah. Drugs D has the whole story of prescription drugs and Medicare has, you know, kind of a lot to it. People would buy additional policies if they had A and B.
Right,
they'd buy themselves a private supplement that might cover drugs sometimes. But now with the new Part D plan, maybe people would buy that instead.
Oh,
and then there's other stuff
and
that's
obviously
going
there's
on.
Probably a C right there.
There's
as
a C
well.
That's
maybe
coming.
We can get
yep.
that to a second. But so A and B traditional, A hospitals, B doctors. And what percent, you know, with my health insurance, there's a copay every time I visit the doctor. It's, you know, $20. How does it work with traditional Medicare with Parts A and Part B?
So if you just have Part A and Part B, then on the Part B side, doctors are covered 80% of the Medicare allowable charges. So Medicare has a fee schedule that governs what doctors can be paid for services, mm-hmm. and Medicare will cover 80% of that, and the patient pays 20%.
I see.
For Part A, it gets a little more complicated, but there's a co-payment that you have to make. If you go to the hospital, Medicare is going to have a copayment of a fixed amount, several hundred dollars coming up.
It's just not as simple as 80-20.
It's not as simple as 80-20. You're going to pay a copayment there too. So, you know, they're not bad coverage, but there's certainly some costs you can run up. And if you're pretty sick, you might really have a bill that's left
and
over after Medicare pays.
There's extreme flexibility here. You can see any doctor you want, go to any hospital you want.
Yeah, Medicare Part A and Part B is, to one way of thinking, one of the last bastions of healthcare as it existed, or health insurance as it existed in America in 1965, 70, 75, when there were really minimal restrictions on what doctors you could see, what hospitals you could use. Doctors get lots of discretion here about the kinds of things services are going to provide, and there's not a lot of oversight that you might see in today's HMOs or other kinds of
things. But there are still, or maybe I'm wrong here, there still are doctors that won't take Medicare patients.
So doctors can elect to be Medicare doctors or not, and some doctors I think decide they have enough business or enough patients from other places, and you know Medicare is a plan, it's got its rules and you have to follow the rules, and some people think that Medicare doesn't pay as well as other options they have, so there are a few. Most of the doctors, the vast majority of doctors in the country, will work with Medicare.
But and you're saying it is kind of the super flexible thing. If you do have an illness, you can go see multiple doctors, get second opinions. You could go to the specialist on the other side of the country. So it is pretty good that way. Although you have to pay, you know, 20% of at least a doctor's visit. So what happens? You know, if I'm a retiree, I don't have a lot of money, and you know I have a major bill. Say I have a surgery, it's $50,000. I know that's more of a hospital inpatient thing, but let's say I have to, you know, pay what are there options so that they don't have to pay that out of pocket?
So there's a bunch of things that go into trying to figure out what the costs to getting this are and how you might get coverage for some of these other services. The main thing that would be the answer to the question is there are supplemental policies. Right. So if you're a retiree and you've gotten Part A because you're eligible for that and you've paid your Medicare tax, and you got Part B, which, for which you do have to pay a little bit of money every month, subsidized, but still a premium you have to pay. You might decide, in addition to that, to pay for a supplemental insurance policy, which you'd buy from a private place. You know, the AARP is one place right. that sells these. There are others, other folks that sell them. You pay an extra premium for that. That's an additional insurance plan that you have, and that might agree, and or you might have a method there to have them cover that 20% copay, the additional hospitals.
I see.
And those plans, there are some different varieties of those that cover more or less generously, and of course charge a higher or lower premium for that.
I see. No, that makes complete sense. And do people have to pay any premium to be in Medicare?
To get A and B both, you have to. A, you generally don't. Mm-hmm. If you pay your Medicare tax for 10 years working, you work for 10 years here, and you pay your Medicare tax, you get Part A for free.
Okay.
But Part B charges a premium, so you do have to pay a small monthly.
And well, it's like on the order of like $100.
Yeah,
a month?
Generally, it's gone up a little bit over time, okay, but something
so
like that.
It's not too much, and you know, maybe $100 or a little bit more per month, which is nothing. I mean, if you're 65 or over and you try to get a private policy, you're probably looking at something like $1,000 a month.
Yeah, so I guess two ways of thinking about it. One, this is heavily subsidized compared to what a person, you know, 75 years old or 80 would pay for a actual private insurance policy. It would be much, much higher than that. You know, there are people who look at that $100 a month and fixed income and Social Security and things, and you say that's an issue. And so one of the things that's just in the news the last few weeks is the fact that the number went up a bit. Social Security payments went up a little bit, but less actually than the Medicare. So people will say,
so
you know,
net,
I'm actually kind of lost
see.
If you're buying both. So there's some people who will still be worried about that, even though it is heavily subsidized and looks like a great deal.
I see. And then finally, so we know A, B, and then we have a little bit of D. We know it's about covering
like
drugs. What does C do?
C is
that it exists.
C exists. C has been around for 20 or 30 years now. C is a separate choice. So when you turn 65, let's say, mm-hmm. You can make this choice a little bit differently sometimes too. But when you turn 65, you might decide to take Part A and Part B, maybe buy a traditional supplement, maybe add the Part D drug plan on, make yourself a package. Or you can elect Part C, and Part C is an alternative. Mm-hmm. Under Part C, what happens is the CMS, federal government, has contracted with some HMOs, Kaiser, Blue Cross, other places. Sometimes they've contracted with a few PPOs. They've tried other kinds of plans too. Mostly it's HMOs. And so you have a choice then. You can join Kaiser and have Kaiser be your Medicare plan. You can join the Blue Cross one. Depending on where you are, you'll have different choices of different private plans that have contracted. And you can do that. The federal government will then pay a bunch of your premium to them.
I see.
So you'll get covered by the private plan with the federal government covering your costs. They might ask you to pay some additional premium. You're going to have to pay your Part B equivalent already, so you got to pay that amount. But then you might have to pay a little bit extra.
I see.
And then you'll get access to what services that has. And so for some people, that's attractive because the co-payments and deductibles will be lower. You'll often have more like the $10 copay.
Right.
You might have access to some prescription drug coverage automatically built in there.
Right.
Sometimes those cover some vision and other things, which might be nice.
So this is, one or two plans. I could get this where it's 80% coverage. Well, I can't make that rule because hospitals, it could be different, but you get this kind of flexible thing, but you have a pretty significant copay, the 20% patient. I could get supplemental insurance for me to cover some of that right over there.
Yep.
Or I can do Part C. Is there a name for Part C?
Part C these days is called Medicare Advantage.
I see.
So the plans in Part C are called Medicare Advantage plans. And so, you know,
which is really just Medicare subsidizing me to get private insurance.
Right. From some plans that have agreed to work with Medicare patients. And you know, they've agreed, they do, there's various checking up on them. So they agree to basically cover everything that A and B would cover, you know, so you're not going to get skimped on too
and
much.
And what do most people do? Do they go A and B, the traditional route, or do they go the C route?
So historically, the vast majority of people have gone A and B route. It changes, kind of goes up and down over time, depending on various factors. But, you know, over a historical average, it'd be something like 80, 85, 90% in A. And maybe 20, 15, 10 in B and C, depending on which year you're looking at over the last 15 years.
Right. And we could probably do a whole series of videos on it. But when did D come about? It wasn't part of the original.
D was not part of the original. D comes about in the early 2000s, mm-hmm. Under George W. Bush.
Mm-hmm.
And
this is what we heard about. I think it was like 2003.
I think that's probably about right. Yeah. And you know, the issue there was there's a lot of folks who were having trouble getting their outpatient drugs covered in there. So this is a plan. This is another part of Medicare. You can elect to buy this. You normally would think about this if you've got A and B and you want to get outpatient drugs covered. You'd think about a D plan. Part D is run by the federal government, kind of the way that C is. They subsidize and they pay a premium to the private plans that cover drugs, and then the person, at least they organize the market, and the person then pays also some premium to get this additionally.
So a private entity will handle the actual reimbursements for the drugs, but Medicare will pay them.
Yeah, so the way to think about it is just a bunch of private entities with funds flows coming in, you know, partly from the person, partly from Medicare to buy these.
Okay, so you would pay, who do you pay your money to? You pay it to Medicare or you pay it to these? I guess it works out the same way one way or the other. But right. You're paying, this is optional, a retiree or someone over 65 would pay money to essentially get a drug plan subsidized.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Cool. Well, this is super.
Actually, you know, I'm trying to think about subsidies, but, you know, there's some interesting questions about the extent to which they're subsidized to be able to participate in a drug plan. I mean, they are subsidized and the federal government is kicking a bunch of money in, but it's a... You know, how exactly the economics of these plans works out has been an interesting discussion the last couple of years.
We could make a ton of videos. No, this is super helpful because I think, you know, frankly, I didn't know about the differences right here before about 15 minutes ago. All right. Well, thanks a bunch.
Mm-hmm.